I just want to say one thing to the fans and everybody in Gator Nation. I'm sorry. Extremely sorry. You know, we're hoping for an undefeated season. That was my goal. Something Florida's never done here. But I promise you one thing. A lot of good will come out of this. You have never seen any player in the entire country play as hard as I will play the rest of the season. And you never see someone push the rest of the team as hard as I will push everybody the rest of the season. And you never see a team play harder than we will the rest of this season. God bless.
6 first-round draft selections. 4 Heisman nominations, 2 Heisman winners, 18 NFL Pro Bowl selections, 1 NFL MVP, a AA All-Star Game selection, 1 sex tape and a murder conviction. Welcome to the locker room of the 2008 Florida Gators.
We get the ball, I promise you one thing, we're going to hit somebody, we're taking downfield, protect them, I guarantee you that. Let's do it again, I'm coming back.
On this, the 10-year anniversary of the 2008 Florida Gators National Championship, we take a look at the players and personalities that made up that now infamous squad. We will investigate their lives both in and out of football, as well as look at the impact these players have made both statistically and financially in the NFL. The Florida Gators are a true blue blood of college football, owning 3 national championships, 8 SEC championships, and having played in 43 bowl games. They've had 89 players receive one or more selections as first-team All-Americans, including 32 consensus All-Americans, 6 of which were unanimous. They've had 3 Heisman Trophy winners and 52 NFL first-round draft picks. A Gator's been selected in every single draft since 1952. They're a football factory. So it came as no surprise in 2008 when the Gators put together a truly impressive lineup of talent. This team was loaded with NFL-level skill. We will look further into the lives of 11 of them. Brandon Spikes, Riley Cooper, Percy Harvin, Carlos Dunlap, Joe Hayden, Marquise and Mike Pouncey, Janoris Jenkins, Tim Tebow, Cam Newton, and Aaron Hernandez. According to the New York Times, a roster on the university's website lists 121 players, 41 of whom who have been arrested, either in college or afterwards, and in some cases, both. That number included 16 players on that season's final 2-deep roster, 9 of whom were starters, as well as a kicker, punter, and returner. Several of those players went on to the NFL. This list is not ranked in order of financial or statistical impact on the game, but rather by personality. We'll place them on what I've come to call the Tebow Hernandez spectrum, the line on which the activities of a football player fall somewhere between that of Tim Tebow and Aaron Hernandez. Tim Tebow, quarterback, free agent. The unquestioned leader of this team, Tebow was beloved at the university, not only for his play, but also his strong faith and leadership qualities. He was coming off a season in which he was the first sophomore to win a Heisman Trophy. He became the first major college quarterback to reach both 20 passing and rushing touchdowns in a single season. He racked up 4,100 all-purpose yards and an impressive 55 total touchdowns. He earned 1,957 points and 462 first-place votes to beat out Darren McFadden and Colt Brennan to win the highest award in college football.
I just like the... First, start off by thanking my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave me the ability to play football and gave me a great family and a support group and great coaches and everything around me. That's how I'd like to start off. And, you know, I'd like to thank the Heisman Trust and everybody here for their support and voting for me. Thank you.
Most critics questioned how his game would translate to the NFL, so it was a bit of a surprise that Tebow would go on to be drafted in the first round at pick number 25 by the Denver Broncos. He would appear in 35 NFL games over three seasons and would throw for 2,422 yards and rush for 989 more, scoring 29 total touchdowns over that time. He became known for his ability to win games while putting up garbage numbers, culminating in a shocking playoff overtime win against the Steelers in 2011. After being released upon the arrival of one Peyton Manning, he would go on to rarely play for the New York Jets. After that, he'd make a brief appearance with the Patriots in 2013, failing to earn a roster spot. It was the last time that we saw Timmy play football. After that, he hung up the helmet and replaced it with a baseball bat. He is currently hitting .266 with 5 home runs and 32 RBI for the Binghamton Rumble Ponies, the minor league affiliate of the New York Mets. His total NFL earning, $9,687,500. Carlos Dunlap, defensive end, Cincinnati Bengals. Dunlap has been a model citizen since entering the league as a second-round pick in 2010, which comes as a bit of a surprise considering the team he plays for. The Bengals seem to have been a magnet for controversy over the last decade or so, but Dunlap has not had so much as a single suspension in his NFL career. The only thing negative you can find about him is the DUI he got as a junior at Florida, which undoubtedly led to his draft day drop.
Florida starting defensive end Carlos Dunlap arrested early this morning. A DUI charge that happened in Gainesville. What would it mean, Kirk, to the Gators if Urban Meyer decides to sit Dunlap out of the SEC title game Saturday, of course, against Alabama?
Well, first, the timing of this could not be any worse. Florida finishes the regular season unbeaten, and finally they have a chance to get to the game that everybody's been waiting to see, and that's the Florida-Alabama game. And you look at Carlos Dunlap and what he has meant to Florida's team this year. He leads the team in sacks. He's right up there in tackles for loss. He's a first-rounder. I mean, he is a difference-maker on the field. And we'll have to wait and see, as you said, what Urban Meyer decides to do with him and his availability. But when he wants to turn it on, he can give an Alabama offense fits. And if they have to remove him, they're still Florida, and they'll still manage, but that would be a significant blow. And as I said, just the timing of this.
Dunlap vowed that it was a one-time mistake and has since lived up to that promise. He has been solid at his position up to this point, as far as football is concerned, playing in 118 games and racking up 244 solo tackles and 64 and a half career sacks, with 2 interceptions and 2 touchdowns for good measure. He's appeared in 2 Pro Bowls, and his NFL career earnings, should he play out his current contract, will be $42,838,000. Joe Hayden, cornerback, Pittsburgh Steelers. Hayden is another guy who, by all accounts, has stayed away from run-ins with the law. He has, however, been suspended once by the NFL in 2012 for testing positive for Adderall.
Joe, do you have anything to say to the fans here?
Oh, of course, man. I like to apologize really about that to my fans, Hayden Nation, the Cleveland Browns organization, the front office, all the coaches. I heard a lot of people. I heard myself for sure, but I heard a lot of people with a decision I made. And I just want everybody to know I'm sincerely. I really sincerely apologize from the bottom of my heart. There's no script. Nobody tell me what to say. I just really feel that, and I want everybody to know that it's a mistake. Everybody makes mistakes, but my mistake happened to hurt a lot more people than I would have thought.
The biggest questions surrounding Hayden largely haven't been off-field concerns. It has been his level of consistency over the years. He was the number 7 overall pick by the Browns in 2010, and while he made 2 Pro Bowls as a member of the Cleveland Browns, he has since been released and is now a member of the rival Pittsburgh Steelers. Given the chance, I'm sure the Browns would go back and take someone like Earl Thomas, who went 7 picks later at 14, Rob Gronkowski, who went at number 42, or for sure Antonio Brown, who went at number 195. Hayden's been okay, really good at times, but has never really lived up to the hype of a top 10 pick. He has currently played in 101 games with 324 solo tackles, 3 sacks, 20 interceptions, and 1 touchdown. His career earnings, should he complete his current contract, will be $102,071,755. Riley Cooper, wide receiver, retired. Quite possibly the least productive member on this list, nothing much was really expected from Cooper as a fifth-round pick. He was selected number 159 by the Philadelphia Eagles in 2010. Riley is probably, unfortunately, best remembered for a video of him at a Kenny Chesney concert in 2013 where he used racial profanity that went viral.
I will jump that fence and fight every n***a here, bro. Ah!
Upon returning to practice, he got into a fight with Eagles teammate cornerback Kerry Williams. I wonder what that may have been over. As for numbers, Cooper was just meh. He appeared in 88 games, catching 169 balls for 2,418 yards and 18 touchdowns. During his career, he earned $11,043,561. Percy Harvin, wide receiver, retired. Percy Harvin's is a story of huge what-ifs. What if he hadn't had debilitating migraines? What if he truly loved football? What if he dealt better with authority? While he had a lot of issues on the field, Percy was never really at odds with the law. Otherwise, he would probably be higher on the spectrum. He had countless issues within the league, as in 2009, he tested positive for marijuana at the draft combine. But that didn't keep the Minnesota Vikings from drafting him 22nd overall in the first round of the 2009 NFL draft. They were repaid in 2010 when he threw a weight at coach Brad Childress during a dispute. In 2012, he infamously was caught on the sidelines of a nationally televised game versus Seattle, screaming at head coach Leslie Frazier.
Here he is talking to Leslie, well, I should say, getting upset with Leslie Frazier. And hard to speculate what he's upset about. Was it the lack of execution and the pass protection? Was it the quarterback?
That was apparently enough to make the Vikings realize they wanted to go in a different direction, and enough to make the Seahawks want him, as they in turn gave Minnesota three draft picks, including their 2013 first rounder for Percy. Harvin was promptly given a 6-year, $67 million deal. He then repaid them by fist fighting Golden Tate in 2012. He then sealed his fate with Seattle by refusing to play in a 2013 loss to the Dallas Cowboys. He was then shipped to the New York Jets for a conditional draft pick, where he had a less than great season and was eventually released. He finished his career after two more lackluster seasons in Buffalo. His career numbers are okay as a receiver, though he should probably be remembered more as a factor in the return game. He played in 75 career games, gaining 9,080 total yards, 4,127 of which were return yards, and he scored 32 total touchdowns. He was named to one Pro Bowl and earned $42,218,382. Mike and Marquise Pouncey, offensive linemen, Los Angeles Chargers, Pittsburgh Steelers, respectively. I combine these two brothers because most of their issues seem to come when they are together. In 2013, both players caught heat for wearing Free Hernandez hats at their birthday bash shortly after the tight end was arrested on murder charges.
Player and former Florida Gator is apologizing tonight after he was photographed wearing a Free Hernandez hat this weekend. The picture shows the Steelers' Marquise Pouncey and his twin brother Mike, who plays for the Miami Dolphins. He issued an apology today. The teams reportedly were expected to talk to their respective players about the photo.
Well, that's not criminal. It is criminally poor taste. The brothers should probably avoid the birthday bashes altogether, as the very next year at their 2014 party, the brothers allegedly assaulted a man along with the assistance of four bouncers at Cameo Nightclub in South Beach. While no criminal charges were filed, they did reach a settlement in 2017 for an undisclosed amount with the man. Mike was also part of the Richie Incognito bullying scandal against Jonathan Martin in 2013. While he was not suspended, he was listed alongside Incognito and John Jerry as instigators of the abuse against Martin. And on a crazy side note, Jonathan Martin himself was recently detained after a disturbing Instagram post caused a shutdown of a local area high school.
Today, he posted a photo on his Instagram story of a gun with bullets all over his bed and the caption, "When you're a bully victim and a coward, your options are suicide or revenge." In the post, he also tagged his former NFL and high school teammates, Richie Incognito, James Dunleavy, TJ Taylor, and Mike Pouncey. He wrote the hashtags Harvard Westlake and Miami Dolphins, the two places he claims he experienced bullying. In the wake of this chilling post, Harvard Westlake, the private school in Southern California, shut down for the day. Only a week after the school shooting at Florida's Stoneman Douglas High School, the school is taking an abundance of caution.
Both of the brothers have been productive by NFL standards. While Mike has been good, appearing in 97 games, making three Pro Bowls, and amassing career earnings of $52,259,695, Marquise has been better, appearing in 92 games, making six Pro Bowls, on his way to racking up $61,013,375. Brandon Spikes, linebacker, free agent. Probably the least known player on this list, Spikes is among the craziest stories. He may be most well known for gouging out the eyes of Georgia running back Washaun Ely during a game in 2009. In 2010, there was a leaked sex tape with a, quote, Kardashian-style woman. And later, in 2010, a failed drug test that would net him a four-game suspension. And in 2015, he was involved in a hit-and-run resulting in injuries to three people. The Patriots would later cut him.
Brandon Spikes went before a judge, a rather lengthy hearing. He walked in today early this morning, and our cameras were the only ones to catch him going into Wrentham District Court. The original intent was for him to go before a magistrate to at least the initial stage of these charges, to hear some of the charges, but then he decided to waive the waiting time for a hearing, and he went before that judge at about 11:30 this morning. He spoke with that judge, and the judge questioned him and had some pretty harsh questions about what exactly happened the night of that accident. You may remember he was in his car on 495. He hit what he initially said was a deer, but it turned out it was another vehicle with a family inside. The family chose not to speak today, so the judge opted, because of Spikes' clean record, to go through with counts 3, 4, and 5. So basically, Brandon Spikes was found guilty of leaving the scene of a personal injury accident. That carries a one-year probation.
Spikes was drafted in the second round at pick 62 by the New England Patriots and was a marginal player with decent stats. He played in 88 games with 212 solo tackles, 2 sacks, and 2 interceptions. He earned $6,859,705. Cam Newton, quarterback, Carolina Panthers. The forgotten member of the 2008 Gators is without a doubt its most successful player in the NFL. Cam went 6 of 12 for 54 yards and no touchdowns passing, and rushed for 113 yards and 4 touchdowns over his 2-year Florida career. But once Cam transferred to Auburn, he was amazing. He would go 185 for 280 with 2,854 passing yards, 1,473 rushing yards, and a total 50 touchdowns, earning him the Heisman Trophy on his way to a national championship win against Oregon in 2011.
First, giving all the honor and glory to God, you know, who is the head of my life. And without him right now, you know, we all would not even be here right now. So thank you for that. I also like to thank my beautiful mother, Jackie Newton, and my father. You know, this...
These numbers convinced the Carolina Panthers to draft Newton number one overall in the 2011 NFL Draft. Cam was not without his issues. It started after leaving Florida, as he was involved in a scandal where his father was attempting to get somewhere between $120,000 and $180,000 for Cam to sign on to play at Mississippi State. He would eventually sign on to play at Auburn. In 2010, while with the Tigers, he was charged with felony burglary, larceny, and obstructing justice for stealing a laptop. When the police arrived, he then threw the laptop, which he had painted his name on, out of the window. Since arriving in the league, Cam has done much better at avoiding controversy, but is still not without his troubles, as in 2017, he caught heat for sexist remarks he made to a female reporter during a news conference.
I know you take a lot of pride in seeing your receivers play well. Devin Funchess has seemed to really embrace the physicality of his routes and getting those extra yards. Does that give you a little bit of an enjoyment to see him kind of truck sticking people like that?
It's funny to hear a female talk about routes. It's funny.
Cam has been really good in the NFL, and at times, he's been truly great. He was the 2015 NFL MVP, leading his team to Super Bowl 50, where they eventually lost to the Denver Broncos. He is a three-time Pro Bowler and has appeared in 109 games, having thrown for 25,574 yards, rushed for 4,320 more, and has 212 total touchdowns. When he finishes his current contract, Cam will have earned $140,492,000. Janoris Jenkins, cornerback, New York Giants. In another case of off-field issues leading to a fall down draft boards, Jenkins fell to the Rams, to my benefit as a fan, at pick number 39 in the second round. Jenkins was unceremoniously released from the Gators in 2011 following a marijuana charge. This wasn't the first, nor would it be the last of the problems for Janoris. He was tased by police during a street fight in 2009. He too caused a social media stir by openly defending Aaron Hernandez in 2015. He would sign with the Giants in the 2016 offseason and keep his nose pretty clean for the most part that year, but was suspended 1 week after not showing up for practice following the Giants' bye week in 2017. That's why New York Giants fans held their collective breath when news broke on June 26th that a dead body was found at his home.
Yeah, Diana, step out of way right now so you can see this is still a very active scene. While I tell you exactly what neighbors are telling us out here right now, the Bergen County Prosecutor's Office has its mobile command set up today along with the Bergen County Sheriff's Office. Now, neighbors are on their porches. They're standing in their yards. They're watching while investigators go in and out of New York Giants corner back Janoris Jenkins' home. This is on Van Saun Place in Fairlawn. We are trying to confirm with authorities exactly what we are being told out here, that a dead body was discovered in the house. The word is that Janoris Jenkins is actually in Florida, and he has been there for a while. But listen to the conversation we just had with one of his neighbors.
I heard from some neighbors over here that they found a dead body in the basement. The nice woman that lives behind us, she said the cops, she came out for a newspaper, and the cops asked her if she heard gunshots. So naturally, she was a little freaked out. We're all a little freaked out. This is a quiet neighborhood. We know that he's not home. He's in Florida. And all we know other than that is someone's there. They won't tell us anything.
Jenkins was out of the state at the time, and his brother William has since been charged with aggravated manslaughter, according to Chief of Detectives Robert Anzalotti of the Bergen County Prosecutor's Office. But with his already murky history, some fans assuredly had flashbacks to June 26, 2013, in a twist befitting this story, 5 years to the day that Aaron Hernandez was placed in cuffs. As far as football is concerned, Janoris has been pretty good. He's a big play corner who at times will either make or allow the big play going for the pick. His numbers are good, but not great. He's logged 84 NFL games, 301 solo tackles, 2 sacks, 16 interceptions, 7 touchdowns, and 1 Pro Bowl appearance. If he finishes his current contract, his career earnings will be $64,841,362. Aaron Hernandez, tight end, deceased. The life of Aaron Hernandez is one of the craziest stories I've ever heard. A talented football player by all accounts, Aaron was plagued with question marks going into the NFL draft. He was likely a late first, early second round pick talent-wise, but the red flags pushed him into the fourth round of the 2010 NFL draft, where the Patriots selected him at 113 overall. At that point, what was known was a history of failed drug tests for marijuana in college. He openly admitted to using marijuana. There were some whispers of gang relation that were at the time unable to be verified, so weren't widely written about. An article on NFL.com by Albert Breer reads, "They couldn't pin a lot of stuff on him at Florida," said one AFC college scouting director, whose team had Hernandez off the board. But people at the school would tell you, every time there's an issue, he's around it. If there was trouble, Hernandez's name would come up. He was a con guy, very believable, spoke well. A lot of things inside you hope you turn him around, but people that I talked to say they didn't trust him, that he'd burn you. And he did. On July 26, 2013, Hernandez was arrested for the murder of Odin Lloyd, and on April 15, 2015, he was found guilty. The story of Hernandez is a long and winding one deserving of more than just a few minutes of discussion. I will not go into the gruesome details as they're widely available via any internet search. He was a greatly troubled young man and was found dead in his cell of an apparent suicide on April 19, 2017. Discussing Aaron Hernandez, the football player, no longer seems to be prudent. I give you these stats, not as a glorification of him, but rather as a chapter in a story leading to an unfortunate ending for all of those involved. Hernandez played in 38 career games. He had 175 receptions for 1,956 yards and 18 touchdowns. He was paid $11,236,000 over the length of his career. This group of players alone have amassed $544,560,999 in combined career earnings, 27,496 combined passing yards, 6,236 combined rushing yards, 8,400 receiving yards, 319 total touchdowns, 1,081 combined solo tackles, 71 and a half combined career sacks, 40 combined interceptions, and a total of 911 career NFL games. This team was one of the most talented ever assembled in college football. It is also, without a doubt, one of its most polarizing. This team outscored opponents 611 to 181. They drew an average of over 90,000 fans every single week. They finished 13-1, with their only loss coming to Ole Miss in week 4, in yet another twist in this story to a team that featured off troubled defensive end Greg Hardy on its roster. They would put up 6,231 yards of total offense on their way to becoming the 2008 national champions. Of all of those impressive numbers, I keep going back to one. 41. 41 of 121 players on this team have been arrested. 33%. That is flat out ridiculous. I don't know what to call it. Maybe it's a curse. Maybe it was coaches overlooking the negatives of players with an eye only on team success. Maybe it's all just bad luck. Maybe it's a combination of all three. What it is for sure is one of the most fascinating stories in all of sports history.
Wish I'd have known.
Before.